Good afternoon. My name is Victor Scholten. I hope my voice is holding this afternoon because I had a little flu over the weekend. But I'm lucky to be here in a vertical position because most of the family is now in horizontal position. I'd like to talk with you about the creativity today. And there are many things said in the past, of course, by other people about creativity. So I was wondering, so how can I say something which is maybe teasing out a little bit more related to the KRM network as well, and about SMEs, how to find maybe opportunities for new businesses and how creativity can help doing that. But maybe I don't have a pointer, so I've walked up and down several times. We all know these kind of things, so how to see whether people are creative. We have these nine dots, and the question is, can we draw a line in there without moving the pencil from the paper? I don't want you to do these things because maybe you've seen those before. And we know that there are some clues here. And maybe there's also these other things that we know which maybe are brain teasers, but sometimes maybe drive you crazy about how to solve these kind of puzzles. And of course they are about creativity. But I'm always questioning, my question is, so how can we make people more creative? I think this maybe if you practice it a lot and you do it over and over again, maybe you get more creative and maybe you learn to think differently or out of the box. But let's just continue. There are some of these companies that are maybe consistently working on creative products, bringing out new creative things that people haven't thought of before or maybe didn't dare to make it, because these are maybe funny kitchen tools from a lessee. Maybe not all companies would take the risk making these. And there are also some of these companies, and maybe you know this company from the US, IDEO, who is maybe also a company, but maybe more on the electronic devices, developing creative products, creative new insights, and maybe a little bit older, which are the PDAs, one of the creative products that they were designing. They have this approach of not only within the devices, but also maybe in other products, in which is a kind of a dispatch, a kind of a needle, which is in a very innovative way to put a medication to someone. And maybe these kind of companies are maybe a kind of imagination to us. So how can we learn from these companies? What are they actually doing, and how do they make people be creative, come up with new ideas? And well, there's this human-centered design approach that they have developed, and I think if you look into their website you can find many examples and many books about that. They have even written themselves a book about it, and once you go into it, it becomes also more complicated. The question is, of course, how actually do they make people more creative, how to make them more creative? Now, there are many books written about creativity, so the question is still, so what is maybe the key asset? So what is making people find more or better ideas? And there's maybe too many of these books. And there's one book maybe standing out, that is the book from Richard Florida, who wrote about the creative class. And he was really pushing it a bit further, saying that it's not only about those artists and those people that make paintings, is much broader, and people that provide services and provide creative products, innovative products. And following that logic, what we have seen over the years, and at least in the Netherlands I could say, is that there are some of these factories which are no longer used, are now used for people to be more creative, bring in different disciplines of people, maybe artists, maybe architects, or maybe different other people, and let them work together and develop new ideas, develop new services, new products, and such like that. So this is just in the Hague. There's a Caballero factory where they put these people together. Also in Rotterdam, there's a Vanilla factory. It happened to be all old cigarette factories for some reason, but that's why they put people together to be more creative. So these are maybe nice examples of how maybe in a very specific building with specific ways of architecture within that building, how to make the environment more conducive to people to discuss with each other, to come up with new ideas or be creative to each other, complementary to each other. And what you see, there's also some of these companies who make that a practice. So there's one, of course, many times mentioned, which is the Google company. This is the example of the Zurich office, if I'm correct. And they have these examples. So we leave people more to do the things themselves they think they are important. We make sure that it is a very nice atmosphere, a very nice environment where people are free to think, free to talk, free to act. They can bring in their bicycle if they like, and they can bring in their pets if they like. So as long as people are open and creative and can leave, we can leave them to do their job. But it's maybe not always that easy, because I would say that is also much about facilitating creativity. And the main question is still out there is, so where do these creative ideas come from? So as a company, if you want to be creative, you may have certain environment which is conducive to make people more creative, but in the end you need them to have great ideas, to come up with good ideas, new ideas. And I just want to give this example of the 3M Post-it, and maybe some of you know this case as well, but just to go through it maybe a bit quicker. We know all these adhesive Post-its, notes, the yellow ones, and they are in all colors today. But if you look back into that case, it was a kind of creative process, and also the exploitation of that creativity process took much longer than one would have expected. And it was actually the inventor that came up with, in a certain program on finding a new adhesive, that it got a new chemical substance for a low-tech, reusable, and pressure-sensitive adhesive. It was pitched toward the top management of 3M at the time, and actually it was pretty useless. It was considered pretty useless because it didn't stick good enough. So what is the purpose of a glue that, it doesn't stick on your fingers as well, but it doesn't stick very strong on paper as well. So it was initially rejected by the company to further work with it, to further explore it, to put more money to it in terms of putting it to the market and make it an innovation. And I think, I don't know it by head, that it took like 10 to 12 years before this guy found someone in his among his friends, because one of his friends was singing in a choir, and he had this sing book. And then you have all these bookmarks to make sure how to emphasize certain sentences or how to step in, and they were falling out all the time. So that was quite annoying for his friend. So he thought, no, maybe I can use that, because maybe if I just put it in my sing book as a bookmark, then it doesn't fall out. Now there is maybe one serendipity for the application. So there's maybe something new and a creative idea, but the creativity is, of course, in applying that idea into a certain innovation and into a market. Well, I should say it's not an innovation here, because there was not really a market. The problem that was actually the next one was, so we have maybe now an application, so we can put it as a bookmark, and we have these adhesive pieces of paper, but how much can we ask for that? So the next question that was rising in 3M was, if you bring it to the market, so how much can we ask? Is it $1 for a piece of paper, or maybe we need 100 pieces of paper, is that $1? What is the value in it? Because the alternative is just a scrap piece of paper, nothing more than that. That's not really valuable. So it was fairly difficult to put a price to it, and they put it into the stores for various prices for a longer period, and no one was really willing to buy it until the moment that they put it into the stores for free. So they gave it away for free. And the reason they gave it away for free was maybe because maybe someone can help me there.
Create a market.
And why did they want to create a market?
Nobody knew the product, so nobody to get familiar with it. Same with Gillette.
Mm-hmm. Say again?
Create the needs,
create the market, you said?
Like Gillette. When the Gillette razor blade was first invented, he gave away the razors for free. And everybody started shaving after a while. They noticed that they wanted more, so they had to buy them.
But there's something more that I'd like to know. Maybe I don't know that one, but the marketing strategy could be. So, what is the story to tell and to sell the thing? Yeah. So, But it's also about trying to get to understand what people value in that product. So how much more do they want to pay for it if they are getting it no longer for free? So it was really trying to develop a kind of a need in the market. So people try to use it. They find it, maybe it's quite valuable. I'm getting used to it. I'm using it in various books. And then the question is, of course, if we take away it for free, and now people have to pay for it, so we can see to it how much are they actually valuing this piece of paper. And that's another step in the creativity process, because if you really want to earn money out of that new innovation, then we also need to know how much people are willing to pay for it. So, and even maybe this one is a silly example of a silly piece of paper and a creation of a new invention coming into the market. There were several of these steps in there. So finding that opportunity. So yeah, who would tell him that he should look in his friends, among his friends who are singing in a choir, using sing books, and then how to find the price for this product. So this is actually all of the process of how to sustain that creativity. So, and actually what we see today is that a lot of these practices are now working in companies to make people more act, more creative, but also think about how to exploit that creative innovation. And maybe one of the important things is about that dominant logic, because if we want to be creative, we also have to do it in a different way. We have to do it differently from what we have done before. So maybe the things we learned yesterday, the way we did things yesterday, it might not be that creative if you do it the same today. So we have to actually escape that dominant logic. We have to think about it in a different way. And actually, there are some of these issues that are helping you to do so, which is actually trying to let go of the mental models we have today. So the cognitive experiences we have today, the experiences, the learning experience, the industry experience, all these types of experience, they make you actually think about solutions in the same direction as we did before, which might be a solution, but maybe not a very sustainable solution. So if you want to make it really different, so really a more creative solution, well, we have to think it from a different angle. We have to do it in a different way. And actually, that's also for a firm very difficult, because that is about decoupling or letting go of existing resources. Well, that's expensive. We have installed, invested in some of the machinery and equipment. We have invested in some of the learning practices and all these mental models, the practicing of business as we do it today. And now we have to let go of these because we have to go creative. We have to come up with new ideas. So that's always a very tight balance here, because how much more do we let go to learn new things? So how to unlearn, actually. But that starts actually with being more flexible about your budgeting and your resource application, so and or research resource allocations. So where do we put our money to, and do we have more flexible budgeting systems as well? You can imagine that the thing that is killing a good idea is that if there's a budget constraint and you're the next year to apply again for your great idea, because then the new budgeting system is there, the new annual financial are clear, so maybe then the idea is maybe good enough to put resources to it. But you can imagine from an entrepreneurial point of view, maybe the window of opportunity has closed by then. Mm-hmm. So all these things are killing for creative ideas. So a flexible budgeting system is very necessary to allow also for creative ideas to be follow up immediately and not wait for the next year or the next budgeting system. Another thing which maybe also is interesting is what we would say, and I'm not sure if this is the right term, is kind of an installed base of customers. Now, what we mean by an installed base of customers is actually the existing customer base that you have as a company. And maybe these are very good customers, because they are loyal to your firm, they provide you the income to your firm, and maybe they also give good hunches on further development. But it's likely that these are very small and incremental developments, and it's not very creative to do something in a very different way. And listening very closely to the majority of the installed base, may give you the wrong directions on how to do and improve things that you already do, because they don't maybe tend to focus on very new things. Of course, there are also customers that are looking for more new things or more demanding customers, and maybe they are more interesting. But your installed base of customers, if it's something really new for needs they don't know or are aware of, it's very difficult to get feedback from them about creative ideas, because maybe they tend to focus on things they have today and they like to improve those things they have today. Now, there's also something like within the organization that is about the freedom to give to one of the employees or to your employees to experiment and to trial and error, and maybe also to fail some of the new products or innovations. So how much do we allow to experiment and to fail, and how much do we calculate within the budgeting system that we allow for failure? Because we need to have these failures if we want to do something really creative. If we say, well, you can be creative but you can't fail, it's not likely that people will be creative. They don't want to take the risk if they know if they fail they are punished for that. So you need a kind of incentive structure as well within such organizations that sustain new creativity. And by that I actually mean you maybe not only give them a bonus, but you make them also responsible or maybe an ownership on their on that creative invention. Because the next thing that is maybe killing a good idea is a boss that is taking the benefit of your creative idea. So that is maybe the last time that an employee was creative in the company. So you need a kind of ownership structures, maybe incentive structures, to motivate people not only to take the risk, but if they are successful, also take the reward of that risk. So actually what I would also always say in my classes, it's much about gaining control by giving up control as a company. So maybe if you have too much control, make it too tight, it's so difficult for people to escape the dominant logic. They will think about the ways that are safe ways to think about. So that is actually one of the main things. But still, there's one question that is not answered. And so the next one, I should say. So maybe we can facilitate this creative environment, so an environment which is conducive to creative behavior. But we need good ideas. But where do these good ideas come from? So where do people find good ideas? How do they run into people maybe that have great ideas? Or maybe how are they formulated? And what we would call them, it's kind of a strategic inflection point. So it's going in a different direction than we would have expected. And where do we find those strategic inflection points? And many times what we see in the literature is saying that it is about leading customers that are very demanding. Maybe also some of the suppliers that come up with new technologies for which they're not sure what the application or how to use it. Maybe that provides also a lot of information for new creative ideas, new ways to experiment. But it's also about looking at what other companies are doing, maybe not directly competitors, but maybe in related industries. Industries that are maybe in a similar kind of field. They are using also technologies, and maybe we should use the similar type of technology as well. So we can maybe learn from other industries as well. And of course, there's a source in the research and institutional organizations. But maybe we want to bring it actually a bit further, which is actually saying that if you want to find good ideas, and there's one of the articles that it's the social origin of good ideas, which actually says where do we need to contact, where people do we need to speak to find good ideas. And actually the main premise of that discussion is that we have to make bridges towards people we haven't met before, we haven't spoken much about before, or maybe they have a different viewpoint on what we are doing. So we actually need to make these bridges to new networks, to new people, to maybe also other countries, to see how do people look at technology, how do people look into markets, how do they use certain equipment, machinery, and maybe we can learn something because we have new information. And if we have a learning point, learning momentum, maybe we can be more creative as well. So actually what we are discussing then is that learning that takes place continually in single domains may be more dependent and hence situated within a single context than learning which spans multiple domains. Saying that if we are talking with the same people, the people we know very well, the people that know me very well, maybe they have the same information, the same background, the same view on the same technology, the same view on the solution that we need. But that doesn't provide me much information for being creative. And maybe also more importantly, I will continue, that if we learn in that single domain, it's not likely that the ideas that come from that domain are diverting much from what we have already known in that domain. So if we are learning in a domain from others in that same domain, it's likely that the ideas that arise in that domain are same compared to the other ideas that already exist. And maybe to put it into a company perspective, it's not likely that the ideas that come out of a single domain, when they are very different from the existing ideas, are very valuable to our customers because they are close to what we already have. So if you want to make a leapfrog or really make a big step into another direction and make it really valuable for the customers, then maybe it's more valuable if you bring in new ideas which are completely new or based on new information. Because if you combine that new information, well, that's something maybe another company hasn't thought of, and you have maybe an advantage, and maybe a competitive advantage you can sustain a little longer than something which is from the single knowledge domain. So actually, to innovate, problem solvers must disentangle the extra knowledge learned in the context of one domain and to see how it can be used in another domain. So if you have this understanding of what the knowledge means in one knowledge domain and we can use it into another knowledge domain, and to put it more in concrete terms, if you know companies in a different sector, they have certain key technologies or working practices, maybe business models, and we can apply that knowledge also in our businesses, then we have something that really differentiates us from other competitors in our domain, and we can make a different price. We can ask a different price as well. So we are more stronger we are in a stronger and a more valuable position towards our customers. So actually, that making the bridge to another network, so it provides also the advantage if you bring in new information, because other companies don't have that new information. And actually, that is the importance of bridging towards new networks. And what we actually mean by bridging is that we are to connect to people in other networks which are not having connections with my network. So if I'm in the industry, in a particular industry, and I'm making a bridge towards another industry, and I'm trying to learn certain technologies or certain business models or certain behaviors of customers, and I try to combine that with the knowledge that I have, maybe I have an advantage over other companies in my own direction. And I'm making it more innovative, I have maybe a more creative idea, and I may, my ideas may last longer. Now, the thing is actually in these differences, because it seems so easy that, so the answer to being more creative is to make bridges towards different networks and to speak with many people as we can in different areas, because then we get as much information as possible. But there's also, of course, an exhausting element in there. So we might get exhausted, and maybe we get over-embedded in all kinds of other networks, and we are getting too much information, and we also have to select out of those informations which is the most valuable ones. And actually, there is a balance to be successful at creativity in how to select your network context. So maybe what we would say, to make it clear in the first instance, is that there is a difference between people that know each other very well, which we would call the kind of bonding tie. So we know each other very well. We have talked with each other for a long time, and actually, maybe we know each other so good, we even visit our families, we visit our birthday parties. So we know each other very well, which is a very tight and bonding type of network. Now, maybe that's good, because that provides a lot of understanding, and we can communicate easily. And maybe also in a company, it's good, because if we are developing a new innovation, we don't want to discuss too much. We just want to bring it out to the market. So we want to speed up the innovation process. So we have communication benefits if we know each other quite well. You don't need to discuss long. Maybe you only need one word or maybe one sentence, and the guy can work on it. And there's not much to explain to it. So it is good for fast development and really bring it quickly to the market. But actually, it provides you also a difficulty if you have too many of these bonding types to come up with good ideas. So the creativity and new information is maybe less when we know each other very well, when we are very tight and communicating in the same way. We have the same beliefs, the same norms, the same values, the same cognitions. Well, that doesn't provide a lot of new inflow of information. So actually then we also need to bridge to other networks. And bridging to other networks is actually connecting with people we don't know. So we are actually a kind of a gatekeeper towards other networks of people, industries, where maybe different habits, different norms and values, different ways of working and different business models are used. And maybe we can learn from that and apply that in our own. And maybe even then we can combine things. We don't need to be the ones that are very good at technology. Maybe I know someone in one network who is good at technology, and I know someone else in another network who's also good at technology. Combine these knowledges, bring these people together. I'm a kind of coordinator, orchestrator of that innovation. But without bringing these people together, the innovation would not be there. So it provides maybe an opportunity to build on knowledge held by other people. And actually, it gives a lot of information benefits, but maybe also some time benefits in terms of by bringing things together, you can do it maybe quicker than competitors because the people were disconnected before, so your competitors, other companies in the area didn't know about that as well. You're the first to bring them together, and maybe you, if you can keep that a secret or you can keep that as a momentum to bring your innovation quicker to the market than the other companies, you have also a kind of an advantage, a competitive advantage, a time benefit. Maybe the opportunity of the window of the opportunity is there and it has closed for your competitors. And maybe there's also some other benefits which are more in the referrals. So maybe if you have more connections to other people, maybe these people know other people as well. This brings you further into the network, which is maybe also very beneficial because you get more information and more valuable information. So it's good for getting new, novel information, getting new ideas in, being more creative, and maybe come up with great ideas. So actually what you see is that companies, they need to balance these two because they know if I only have these bridging ties, you can imagine it's also a difficulty because if I only have new inflows of information, I also need to act on that. I need to make sure that it is getting into an innovation and I'm bringing it to the market. And by that I mean if you have too many of these bridging ties, every time you get new information, but you need to have these people also act in the same way. Whereas actually in the bonding ties it was much more easier because these people knew each other, they know how to speak with each other, they know how to communicate with each other, they don't have maybe cultural differences, language differences whatsoever. So it's much faster to get things moving ahead out on the market. That's a difficulty in the bridging ties. So what you see actually is that, and this is something also from literature in discussions, that how to combine these. And what you actually see is that in the early stages of the innovation, of the creativity process, it's much more about these bridging ties, bridging towards new networks, getting out there to get new information. But as the idea is getting more mature, we're getting more better understanding of what it can do and where the application is, we have to actually bring that into a bonding network, a more tighter network, a more closed network, where people are better communicating with each other because we want to bring that new invention also to the market. The biggest problem with the bridging ties, or the trap with the bridging ties is that there are so many different cultures and different people that they remain questioning the purpose of the innovation. Maybe we can further improve it. I got some new ideas. I've spoken with these people in that organization. Maybe we should look at it from another angle. And it remains on discussing about how to use that. So you need to escape that at a certain moment. You need to escape and to put it into a practice and to make it sure that it is more in a bonding tie situation where people are close connected to each other. They are not questioning anymore what the maybe I'm exaggerating a bit, but they are not quarreling about the innovation anymore. They are just trying to bring it to the market. Now maybe that's good to mention that networks actually they do provide two things. And to understand really, so we need to be creative. We need to get new ideas into these organizations, but also we need to get the innovation outside of the organization. So we need actually these bridging ties to get the information and the novel information in, but we need the bonding ties to get the innovation done and to bring it out on the market. Actually, what we also say in these bridging and bonding ties, there are two problems. One is actually the ID problem, and the other one is the action problem. So if you have too many bonding ties, too many tight networks, we don't talk with other people, we tend to work and talk with people we know very well. It seems maybe at the end that we are stuck with the problem. We don't find the good problems. So we have an ID problem. But if we are looking into many different people with different perspectives, different goals, different objectives, maybe they have different incentive structures, it might be good that they all give you new information, but if you want them to act as well, it might be more difficult because they are disconnected somehow, they are in another organization, so how can I give the incentives to make them act in the way that I like them to act? So there's maybe an action problem. So how can we put things together? How can we really make the innovation to the market? How can we align the incentives of all the people that are maybe not in my own organization and are disconnected? So this is actually the problem, what we would call the action problem. Now, and actually what we get is a kind of four barriers in that collaboration that may limit the creativity of an organization. And maybe one is more the motivation. So how to motivate people that they are collaborating or looking for new ideas. And the other one is maybe more related to the ability. So how are they able to search for new ideas? And if they are they willing or able to transfer that idea? So you get a transfer problem as well in the bridging ties. So maybe you know these other organizations, but are they willing to share that information with you, or are they willing to collaborate with you? And if they don't, you see there's an opportunity, there's a good idea, we can be very creative and make a difference in this industry, but if they are not willing to work with me, we have an action problem. And actually that is, we cannot work well together. There's not a very good chemistry. These kind of examples may work. So there's four of these problems, four of these barriers. It's maybe the first one about idea identification. We didn't invent it, it's not our invention. So we are opposing it, we are not really willing to reach out to it. So what you get is maybe if the invention or the idea or the creativity is a combination of information which is also in other organizations, maybe people don't like to go out because it's not my idea, it's not our one's idea. And you can imagine in particular with larger organizations and with manager positions, they like to own that idea. They like to own that invention, maybe also the intellectual properties that go with that invention. Because if not, then they have to share the benefits as well. And as a manager, maybe you want to keep control and own that control. So maybe there's difficulty they don't want our. It's also maybe an issue of hoarding that they don't are willing to share the information. They are not willing to give out that information because what is the benefit for me? So you need the incentive structures as well because that stops you from acting on it. On the other hand, the search problem, I don't know where to find and how to look for good help, where to look for other organizations. And maybe if I just continue, there are some of these issues maybe that can help resolve those. And that's a stepwise problem approach. So the problem to identify opportunities is actually maybe related to the not invented here syndrome. So it's not my idea, it's another one's idea. maybe that wouldn't be too bad, but it might be the manager who is not controlling that idea, is not controlling the ownership of the patent or the intellectual property rights, and is not willing to make use of that because he has to share the benefits and the rewards that he gets from that innovation. But actually what you want is to get people out of there, to have an organization that is maybe more mixtured. Well, there's others maybe later in this afternoon that will explain a bit more about that, but the importance is to get more diversity in the team, more different people, and maybe also look in other networks of people. And I think maybe today is also such an opportunity to speak with people from other industries, to speak with other people from other networks. And I think that is important. So looking and talking with people we haven't met before might fuel you with new information which you haven't thought of, or new perspectives which you haven't thought of, and maybe give you some ideas, or maybe trigger some ideas with you, some more creative ideas. It's also about building the diversity and not the size. Many times it says, well, I've got networking is important, and I've got a very, very large network. But if this large network of people is the people that are all the same backgrounds and all the same beliefs and the same knowledge they have, it doesn't provide you much more information. It's about the diversity. So it's much more important to speak with people from a different background. They may have a different view on the problem. They have maybe a different solution to that problem. And maybe it's not valuable in all instances, but maybe only a few times is good enough. It's also then about building bridges and not look into the familiar faces. Speak with people we haven't spoken with before. Be open. Look into weak ties, as we also call it. People we haven't spoken much about. We don't know much very good. We only know them very shortly. Maybe people you run into in a certain event, in a different industry, and maybe he knows someone who knows. And there is maybe a new opportunity for creative innovation. So it's about building those weak ties and not the strong ties of people we know very long, because the people we know very long, they may have the same ideas that we have, maybe the same solutions to the problems that we have, and maybe they don't see the problem as maybe someone who is very new to the field would see the problem. So it's maybe better to look outside to other people. Then the problem is, of course, the action problem, how to capture the value of it. So maybe if we can escape the identity, the identification problem, the ID problem, and we can have novel information and we have new inputs, we need to put it to practice and to put it into an innovation. And then we are to overcome these issues like hoarding and the transfer problem. Well, maybe the hoarding problem is, of course, to influence the situation, to make people more positive about it and to swarm around it and not do it yourself, to work with other people, to get a kind of network that is mobilizing or putting positive words out about that new. So building a kind of trustful network where people are more positive about it. Now the other one is the transfer, and that's how to transfer that knowledge when it's more difficult. And that is actually make that relationship much stronger. Because the thing that is people keeping it from transferring knowledge, so what are the main difficulties when to transfer knowledge? Some of the information is very difficult to transfer because it's so difficult to explain how to do it, like riding a bike. You have to practice that, and maybe you have to help someone doing it before he really knows how to do it. And that's maybe also with some of the technologies that we have. Maybe if we want to transfer that, you also need to go along with it. Maybe you need to explain to it, maybe you need to work together with it, and maybe then it's better understood how to use it and how to apply it. So not all of the information we can put down into a report and we can read from the report like a manual how it should be used. Now there's also something maybe what we would call latent codified information. So we could have written it down, but many times we don't write it down. And in research, I think it happens many times that the only thing that we put down in papers is what works well, but we don't put in the paper what doesn't work well. And maybe sometimes it's a lot of information on things we haven't written down on how it doesn't work. And maybe in that case, transferring knowledge, we could have written it down, but we haven't it. So maybe it's good also to include the inventor, because he knows when it doesn't work. And maybe only from the papers we know when it works, but we would like to know when it doesn't work as well. So that is what we would maybe call kind of latent codified information. We could have written it down, but we didn't do it. Maybe other issues with transfer of knowledge? How to improve that? Or what is keeping people from transferring knowledge?
Yeah, I think sometimes it's more difficult also to define what is understood.
Mm-hmm.
What you said, when we are talking in the same community, people we know with the same background, there are some things we think they're acquired, and we just talk the way as it would be acquired. But if we are confronted, for example, to other people with a different background, with a different culture, for example.
Yeah, translation.
And then you have, you realize, saying the same thing, just people look at you, they don't understand. So there are certain kind of references which exist in our head, which we have to translate now and bring them down on the bottom line. So okay, this is not acquired actually. This person in front of me, just having a different culture, not having the same references.
Yeah.
I have to explain this.
Yeah.
And I think you have to really lay down everything, and then start from the bottom again to define the references. And I think that's maybe also what you said before, so challenging in intercultural projects, because you have to redefine your references. And so I think it's stimulating.
Yeah.
Actually.
Now, it's indeed very, the one thing that is maybe also having it difficult for the transfer of the information is, maybe I can explain it to you how it works and you completely understand with one hand, I explain the same to you, you don't, because you don't have the same background of information, the same reference field, or maybe there's maybe other things that are you don't completely understand of what we are doing in our field. So there is a kind of common knowledge, common value, same beliefs, same language, same wordings that are also required. And that's maybe better if we have people we know longer, we have a stronger connection with, we have maybe worked before together, we are from the same industry or discipline. So actually what we need to do is to make those connections in the very beginning, which are very loose and disconnected and in different networks and very bridging towards other sectors. Now we have to make them more stronger to have a more common understanding of what we are talking about, the knowledge, the language that we speak. Maybe also important is that we are learned to trust each other, so we know how to act, not to take opportunity of this situation, and that we can really share information without the other violating the relationship. But I just want to mention it, that if we are to be more creative in the organization, we have to step out the organization, step out the industry, maybe the region or maybe the country, and look into different areas and get fed by many of new information and maybe select out which are more relevant to us, and then develop stronger relationships with these people and these information so that we can make it to work. Actually, there's some of these steps which are maybe good to mention then, is that, look outside your organization, build diversity, not size, so build to different kinds of units, knowledge, demographics, genders, nationalities. Many contexts, the similar people is less valuable for creative ideas. So actually we need to go out, and actually we need to build weak ties. And that is very scary sometimes for organizations, or maybe also for people, to talk and to go out there and to disclose a little bit on what you're doing and what your technology is, what your company is about, what the questions are you are struggling with, because that maybe also show a little weakness of you as an organization. But I think you need it to get the discussion going. So you need to discuss with maybe weak people we haven't heard much or we haven't spoken much about before to get new information. Because if you are circulating in existing networks, it's likely you get existing information you knew already, solutions you knew already. So it's about you making these bridges. Don't go it alone. Maybe also look into intermediate organizations that can help you make these bridges towards other organizations. And then the next few steps is about making it more tighter, making the networks more stronger. So how can we actually make people not to take advantage of the situation? How to make them aligned with the goals that we have? So we need to have certain influence tactics, so to make sure that people are getting motivated, because they are maybe from a different network, now they are maybe feeding me with new information. I need them to be also interested in the things that I'm doing, because I need them to share with me the information, to work with me on that innovation and to collaborate. So you need actually a kind of influence tactics on how to make people more interested. And maybe that's about reciprocity, which is maybe one of the things that helps good. There's other ways maybe that are also used, like threaten. And then, of course, it's important to switch from weak ties to stronger ties, to make sure that they are the same language that we speak, the same knowledge we share. And actually, I think one of the equations that we use is, if we want to make our networks more creative and effective in creativity, then it's about how to identify the opportunities, but also how to exploit that opportunity, how to capture the value of that opportunity. Because maybe if you only have great ideas and you don't put them into practice, then it's of little use as well. So it's about identifying opportunities, build outward networks, look for new people in diverse networks, build many weak ties with people we haven't spoken with before, maybe new in different events. They are new people to us. They feed us with new information. So if you make these bridges to other networks, to other industries, to other companies, you get more novel information, which is good maybe for creativity and opportunities. But then we have to make them interested as well, to have them contributing to our goals and to have shared goals and shared interests. So we have to make it a stronger tie network. And actually, we have to switch more towards stronger ties, make the relationship much more intense and is stronger, to make sure that they are also understanding what we are doing. We are maybe quicker at developing that innovation and creative ideas to the market. But also, people don't make an don't act opportunistically about what we are doing. They are not violating the relationship. They are not leaving the area before we are to the market with a product. So actually, what you see is that organizations that were used to maybe do it much more themselves in the innovation funnel, the research, and putting it to the market, do it all themselves, like many good ideas themselves, and trying to put them in their own market, we see now is that organizations are trying to do it much better with other organizations, and maybe also with more diverse networks. So maybe some of the ideas we can also put into practice in other markets, license out and spin out, but also maybe important is to get new ideas from outside the organization and feed them into your own organization and put them in your own market. So you get a much more flexible approach, more creative approach on how to benefit from information which is maybe not within your organization, but maybe not only within your environment, direct environment of the industry, but maybe also in other industries and other countries. And actually what you see is that on these peripheries of the organization, you will see that there are many of these bridging ties, reaching out to new information in other organizations, in other networks, in other countries, and at the same time developing bonding ties within the organization and within the network of collaboration with other organizations to make it more tight and make sure that the innovation also is getting to the market at the end, because otherwise we have a good, great, creative idea, but we haven't brought it to the market. And actually that is the main discussion that I have, and it's actually not to get into that cubicle to think out of the box, but get out of that cubicle to think out of the box. Maybe there are questions.